Hello everyone. So in the last class, we had discussed the transfer functions for electromechanical system, wherein we had an armature controlled DC motor coupled to a mechanical load, right? And we had built a big block diagram, if you remember, right? So in most of the practical systems, there will be subsystems within a system, right? Connected to different subsystems in a different ways. So in today's lesson, we are going to see how we can reduce a big block diagram to find the overall transfer function. Okay, a system can have many systems within it, which we call subsystems, right? So all these subsystems will be connected to one another in many possible ways. Okay, so unless we know how to reduce the block diagram, we cannot find the overall transfer function for the overall system. So that is today's objective. Let's begin with. So this was the block diagram that I had shown for a closed loop transfer system, control system, right? We had an error detector, or the thing that is shown in circle, that is called error detector. Okay, there was a controller, there was an actuator, there was a process, and there was a sensor. Okay, so from now on we will be using a different notation, right? If I write this as G of S, okay, it means G of S represents a controller. Okay, G of S is a transfer function that has captured the dynamics of the controller. Okay, so we will not write controller or actuator like that. We will simply represent each element with its respective transfer functions. Okay, so say for example, I'm writing this as G1 of S, this as G2 of S. It means G2 of S is my actuator transfer function. Okay, similarly, H of S, it means H of S is my sensor transfer function. Okay, so that is what we are going to do from now on. Now, before we move into the block diagram reduction rules, we have to first understand what are the basic elements in a block diagram. Okay, so as you can see here, there are arrowheads. Okay, arrowheads indicate how the signals flow from one point to another. Okay, so they are always unidirectional. Signals can flow only in one direction. Okay, hence this arrow like this. Okay, it means that the input signal R of S is flowing forward. Okay, the output signal C of S is flowing like this. So arrowheads are used to indicate signal flow. Then we have blocks. Okay, as I said before, within the block we will represent the system and with its transfer function. By the way, what is transfer function? Ratio of Laplace transform of output to Laplace transform of the input when all initial conditions are zero, or it is the Laplace transform of the impulse response of the system when all initial conditions are zero. You remember that, correct? So this block, if I write G of S within the block, it represents, it is the transfer function of that block. Okay, so if the signal is R of S, if input signal is R of S, what is my output signal C of S? It will be G of S into R of S, or R of S into G of S. You can interchange the order, it's not a problem here. Okay, G of S into R of S. Signal, the input signal gets multiplied with the transfer function returned within the block to give you an output signal. Fine. This is called a summing junction, okay, or error detector. Error detector. Okay, so you see here that one signal is coming at a positive polarity. Then signals may come from the bottom part or from the upper direction like this. Okay, so all signals that come except the main, the one coming to the main channel will have to carry some polarity. Okay. Say for example, this I may mark it as plus. Okay, but here even if you don't mark plus, it is understood that R1 of S is always a positive polarity. Okay, so except R1 of S, that means except the signal coming from the main channel, all other signals should have appropriate polarities marked. Okay, so you see R1 of S is coming at positive polarity, R2 is coming at positive polarity, R3 is at negative polarity. So what is the effective signal? R1 plus R2 minus R3. Okay, if there's an additional signal like this, say R4 at positive polarity, then it would have been plus R4 of S. Okay, so summing point or an error detector will add or negate the signals depending upon the polarity. So there can be many inputs to the summing point, but there is always one output from the summing point. Okay, there are many inputs. Okay, if you want, you can have R5 at negative polarity. Then this would have been minus R5, plus R4, minus R5, and so on. Okay, there can be many inputs, but only one output. C of S. Okay, that is what is called summing junction or error detector or summing point. Now we have something called a pick off point. Pick off point, it is also called take off point. Take off point. Okay, what does it do? So it is normally represented by a solid dot. Okay, so an input signal is coming here, right? You can draw concurrently any number of branches which will carry the same signal. Okay, if I draw one more branch here, it will be R of S. Okay, draw another branch from here, it is again R of S. Okay, so there can be one input to a pick-off point or a take-off point, and there can be many branches which are having the same signal concurrently. Okay, so one input signal and many output signal in the case of a pick-off point or a take-off point. Whereas in the case of a summing point or an error detector, there are many inputs and one output. Now, there are two blocks. Two blocks are connected like this. Okay, output of the first block forms the entire input of the second block. Okay, let the input to the first block be X1. This signal is marked as X2 and this is X3, right? So what is X2 in terms of X1 and G1? It will be X1 of S into G1 of S. Okay, that will be X2. Now what will be X3? It will be nothing but X1 of S into G1 of S, G2 of S. Okay, so now you take the whole transfer function. This is the output of the signal, Laplace transform of output of signal, right? So what will you get? You will get G1 of S, G2 of S into X1 of S divided by X1 of S. That means what? These two blocks can be replaced by a single block whose equivalent transfer function is G1 S, G2 S. Because what is X3 here? X3 is nothing but G1, G2, X1. Okay, I forgot to tell you here, everything is in Laplace domain. So you can omit this G1 of S. Instead of G1 of S, you can simply say G1. It is understood that G1 simply means G1 of S. X1 simply means X1 of S. It is understood. Okay, you should not forget that it is always a function of S. Okay, the Laplace variable. So it means that these two blocks can be replaced by a single block whose equivalent transfer function is G1, G2. Okay. So this is why it is called blocks in cascade or blocks in series. Okay, this is called blocks in cascade or blocks in series. Output of first block forms the entire input to the second block. Okay, blocks in cascade or blocks in series. Then suppose originally you are having a configuration like this. Okay, the summing point to the left side of the block G. I want to shift the summing point to the right side of block G. How to do that? This is the transformation equivalent diagram. Okay, so instead of by heart, you should understand how we are getting that. Okay, so I will explain that. This is summing point. How many inputs do we have? Two inputs. Which are they? X1 and X2. How many outputs? One output. What is that? It is nothing but X3, which is equal to G into X1 plus minus X2. Okay, so we are just rearranging the components. We are not altering the signals. So the signal should remain unaffected. Okay, so the two input signals and the one output signal, they should not be affected by interchanging the position of G and the summing point. Okay, so signal should remain the same. Okay, so when you shift that, first you will have a block. First you have the block with G here. Okay, then comes the summing point. Okay, right, so inputs and outputs should remain the same. Let the input be X1. Okay, it is coming in positive polarity, right? So this signal output must remain the same. G into X1 plus minus X2. Correct? Now what's the second input signal? It is X2. Right? X2 is coming here. Fine. Now, this is the total output signal. What is the signal at this point? Signal at the output of G, it will be X1G. Okay? What's the total output? Gx1 plus minus Gx2. Okay, out of which we already have Gx1 here. Okay, so what should be this signal? This signal must be plus minus Gx2. Okay, but what's the input signal? Input is X2. Means what? There has to be a block. There has to be a block with the gain of G. Okay, because output divided by input. Gx2 divided by X2. It will be G. Okay, that is how you are getting this equivalent diagram. Fine. Okay. So we can shift this. When you shift the summing point to the right side of the block, what happens? The block transfer function will appear in the feedback, in the second channel path. Am I clear? Next, suppose originally the summing point is to the right side, right? I want to shift the summing point to the left side. What I should do, you think? So first summing point will come, then block will come. Okay, everything else will remain the same. So this is x1. So what is the output? What is the output signal there? Output signal x3 will be what? X1g plus minus x2. Okay, so my output here also should remain the same, right? X1g plus minus x2 should remain the same, correct? So here is the second input, that is x2. Okay, now this is the output signal. What is the input to the block? How can you find that? I repeat, this is the output signal. Okay, we know the transfer function. How will you find the input signal? Output signal divided by transfer function. So that means at this point you must have what? X1g plus minus x2 divided by g. That means you should get x1 plus minus x2 divided by g. Okay, x2 divided by g, out of which we have x1 here. X1 is always coming at positive polarity, right? So this, when you subtract x1 from this, you will get plus minus x2 by g. So plus minus. Okay, so signal at this point must be x2 by g. Okay, but what is the signal input? It is x2. So output divided by input signal, x2 by g whole divided by x2, you will get 1 divided by g. Okay, that is what is shown here. Fine. One by g. Okay, so when you shift the pickoff point to the left side of the block, 1 by g will appear in the second signal path. Okay, you should remember these things because there are complicated block diagrams which are to be solved. Okay, so this is how to transfer shift summing points to the left side and right side of the block. Okay, now we want to shift the pickoff point to the left side of the block. What is to be done? Okay, again same thing. So what is x2 here? X2 is nothing but X1G. Clear? Because this signal is X1G. This is a pickoff point. So here also I should have X1G. Correct? Now how to shift the pickoff point to the left side of the block? Okay. So first pickoff point will come, then G, the block will come G. Okay. So inputs and outputs should remain the same. How many inputs do we have here? One input, and that is X1. How many outputs? Two outputs. Which are they? X1G. Okay. And one more output must be there, which is x1. Okay. Now, what's the signal? What is so this is the pickoff point. So this signal is x1. What is this signal? It is x1. What is this signal? It is also x1. But what is the output signal? Output signal is x1g. Okay. So what should be the gain of the block? It must be x1g divided by x1, which is nothing but g. That is what is shown here. Okay. So if you notice here, shifting the summing point to the right side, okay, what happened? A block gain G appeared in the feedback path. So shifting the summing point to the right side and pickoff point to the left side, it has the same effect. A gain G will appear in the second signal path. Am I clear? Now, going to the next transformation. Originally, the pickoff point is here. I want to shift the pickoff point to the right side. How to do that? So what is x2? X2 must be g into x1, right? How many inputs do I have here? Two inputs. One input. One or two? One input. Which is that? It is x1. So this x1 is the output signal, okay? And this gx1 is the second output signal. So I have one input to the pickoff point and two outputs. Which are they? One is g1x and one is x1. So how to shift this pickoff point to the right side of the block? So first block should come g, okay, then pickoff point should come. Okay, so inputs and outputs should remain the same, x1, x1. This must be gx1, fine. So this signal is gx1. So what is this signal? This is also gx1. Okay, so what is this signal? being a pickoff point, the input, its output must also be GX1. But what is the output coming from this? Output must be X1. Means what? There has to be a block whose transformation is output divided by input, which is nothing but 1 divided by G. 1 divided by G. That is what is shown here. Okay. So this is how to transshift summing point and pickoff points to the left and to the right, or beyond and ahead of the blocks. Fine. Now two blocks are in parallel. Okay. So you see, what is signal at this point? It is X1. Signal at this point is X1. What is signal at this point? X1, G1. Signal at this point is X2, X1, G2. Okay. So what is X2? X2 will be X1 into what? G1 plus minus X2. Okay. So when you take the overall transformation, this divided by X1, what will you get? You will get G1 plus minus X2. Means what? These four components. Which are the four components? One pickoff point, two blocks, and summing point. They can be replaced by a single block whose equivalent transformation is G1 plus minus G2. Okay? So this is called blocks in parallel. You see, it starts from a pickoff point and ends at the same summing point. Okay? It starts from here. This arrow ends at this summing point. The second branch, which starts again from this pickoff point, ends at the same summing point. Okay, that is why we say the blocks are in parallel. Okay, it is like as if two resistors are in parallel, right? If you remember, this is like two resistors in parallel, like this. Okay, starts from this point and joins at this point. Okay, so it starts from this pickoff point and joins back at this summing point. Two blocks in parallel. Now, this configuration is called feedback configuration. We had already seen this. Okay, this is the standard form. So by G of S, I mean it will indicate the transformation of all the elements in the forward path. So this is called the forward path. Starts from the input and goes towards the output. Okay, so here we had the controller, here we had the actuator, here we had the plant. Okay, and we had seen when the blocks are in cascade, they can be combined into a single block. So my G of S represents the plant, the controller, and the actuator. Okay, and this is the transformation for the sensor that is used for feeding back the signals to the error detector. Okay, so this is called the error detector or the summing point, right? And this, and if you remember, this is called error signal or actuating signal. Fine. Now, how can we replace this thing? What is my output signal here? C of S. C of S is equal to. Okay. So this is, what is the input to the block? G of S, E of S. So what is the signal? This must be G of S into E of S. Okay. What is the signal? G of S into E of S. Okay. So what is E of S? I can write that as G of S into E of S. Correct? G of S into E of S. Right? Now what is E of S? But what is E of S? E of S is nothing but R of S. What? Minus plus this signal. What is this signal? This signal will be what? G of S, H of S, E of S. Correct? The input to H of S block is G of S into E of S. So the signal at this point will be what? It gets multiplied with the block transfer function. G of S, H of S into E of S. So I can write E of S as R of S minus G of S, H of S, E of S. Okay, so what will be my C of S? C of S will be G of S into E of S. Instead of that, I can write G of S into. So what will be E of S from this? You take this term to the left side. Okay, take this term to the left side. So what will you get? You will get E of S whole into 1 plus GSHS. Equal to what? R of S. Okay. So what is E of S from this? R of S divided by 1 plus GSHS. Okay. So E of S will be G of S into R of S whole divided by 1 plus GSHS. So means what? C of S by R of S will be what? Nothing but G of S divided by 1 plus GSHS. Okay, so it means that these four components, which are the four components, summing point, two blocks, and the pick-off point, can be replaced by a single block whose equivalent transformation is this. Okay. Now, when you use a negative sign here for the feedback signal, you will get negative feedback. If you are using the positive polarity for the feedback signal, you will get a positive feedback system. Okay. One thing to be remembered is that if the feedback is negative, then in the denominator you have the positive term 1 plus GSHS. Whereas if the feedback is positive 1, then in the denominator you have a negativity. Okay, G divided by 1 minus GSHS. Okay, so this you have to remember. Okay. Now before we move further, so as I said before, G of S is in the forward path. So G of S is called forward path transfer function. Okay, what is H of S? That represents the transfer function of the sensor, which is in the feedback path. So H of S is called feedback path transfer function. Right? Now, product of these two, G of S and H of S, that is called open loop transfer function, or simply loop transfer function. Okay? GSHS is called open loop transfer function, or simply loop transfer function. Now, C of S by R of S, what will be that? That is nothing but what? G divided by 1 plus GSHS, we are just now seeing. Okay, G of S divided by 1 plus GSHS. That is what is called a closed loop transfer function or control ratio. Okay, and the denominator of the closed loop transfer function, that is called characteristic polynomial. Okay, so 1 plus GSHS is called characteristic polynomial. When you equate that 1 plus GSHS to 0, what would you get? You would get what is called characteristic equation. Okay, characteristic equation. Is that fine? Now let us look into much more depth of these things. So G, what is G of S? G of S, H of S, GSHS, G by 1 plus GSHS, they are all transfer functions. And we know transfer function is the ratio of two polynomials in S. What is transfer function? Ratio of Laplace transform of output to Laplace transform of input when all initial conditions are zero. So that means each transfer function is a ratio of two polynomials in S. Fine. So let G of S be Ng by Dg. N is the numerator, Dg is the denominator of the G of S. Right? And H of S is Nh divided by Dh. It has again another numerator, it has another denominator. Okay. So what is the open loop transfer function? Product of these two GSHs. So it becomes Ng Nh divided by Dg Dh. We just have to multiply these two. Okay. Okay, so these two just needs to be multiplied, right? So you get Ng Nh divided by Dg Dh. That is your open loop transfer function. Fine. What is characteristic polynomial? Denominator of the closed loop transfer function. That means 1 plus GSHS. So what will you get in 1 plus GSHS? You just have to substitute these things into this equation. Take the LCM and simplify. So you will get Dg Dh plus Ng Nh divided by Dg Dh. Fine. Now, what is closed loop transfer function? G of S divided by 1 plus GSHS. So simply substitute this G of S and H of S like these values. Take the LCM, simplify. You will get Ng Dh divided by Dg Dh plus Ng Nh. Now, this is important. Why? Now, so you see, I told you transfer function is the ratio of two polynomials, right? Roots of the denominator of a transfer function, they are called poles. Poles of the transfer function. Okay. What are poles? Poles are the roots of the denominator of the transfer function. Or in other words, poles are those values of S which make a transfer function infinite. Okay. Say for example, you have some transfer function like this. S plus 1 divided by, okay, S into S plus 2. Right? What did I say? I said that poles are those values of S which make a transfer function infinite. Say, when S is equal to 0, what happens? This transfer function becomes infinite because something by 0, it is indeterminate. It is indeterminate. Okay? Or if you put S equal to minus 2, what happens? The transfer function again becomes undefined. Okay? Or infinite. Okay? or if you put both s equal to 0 and minus 2, the system is again cannot be detected. The system value is undefined. Okay, so those values of s which make a transfer function infinite, they are called poles of the transfer function. Similarly, there is a concept called zeros. What are zeros? Zeros are those values of s which make a transfer function equal to 0. For example, put s equal to minus 1 here, right? If you put s equal to minus 1 into this transfer function g of s, what happens? It becomes 0. Okay, so what are zeros? Zeros are the roots of the numerator of the transfer function. What are poles? Poles are the roots of the denominator of the transfer function. Okay, now so coming down, so our open loop transformation we had found. Okay, so this is ngnh divided by dgdh, right? And the characteristic polynomial, again you will get dgdh plus ngnh divided by dgdh, right? And the closed loop transformation is ngdh whole divided by this thing, dgdh plus ngnh. So you can observe here one thing. See here, what is the characteristic polynomial? Characteristic polynomial, this characteristic polynomial is important in the sense that it will closely relate, it will connect the open loop poles and the closed loop poles. What are the open loop poles? DGDH, roots of DGDH. Okay, so the denominator of the characteristic polynomial is nothing but the open loop denominator or corresponding to open loop poles. Now what are the closed loop poles? Closed loop poles are the roots of DGDH plus NGNH. What is the numerator of the characteristic polynomial? Same thing, DGDH plus NGNH. That means roots of the numerator of the characteristic polynomial will give you the closed loop poles. Okay, whereas the roots of the denominator of the characteristic polynomial will give you the open loop poles, because this part and this part, they are one and the same. Okay, this is DGDH, this is also DGDH. So open loop poles, they correspond to open loop poles. Now this DGDH plus NGNH, which is in the numerator of the characteristic polynomial and the denominator of the closed loop transfer function, one and the same. That means they correspond to closed loop poles. So that is what is written here. Poles of 1 plus GSHS are same as open loop poles. Okay, and zeros of 1 plus GSHS are same as closed loop poles. Keep in mind, zeros are those values of S which make the transfer function zero. So the roots of this numerator of the characteristic polynomial will give you zeros. So zeros of the characteristic polynomial correspond to the closed loop poles. Okay, so characteristic polynomial will relate open loop poles and closed loop poles. So maybe after 20-25 hours of lecture, we will see. This is a very important concept. Okay, so we will again revisit this thing and do further analysis. Okay, now let's take up a block diagram. Okay, so you see, this is not in a simple form. That is why we had seen the block diagram algebra. Okay, so are there any blocks in cascade? So we are, the question is to find the transfer function between y of s and r of s. Okay, are there any blocks in cascade? G1 and G2, they are not in cascade. Why? Because there's a pick-off point in between. Two blocks are in cascade only if the output of the first block forms the entire input to the second block. Okay, so this G1 and G2 are not in cascade. Any blocks in parallel? G1 H3? No. When will you say blocks are in parallel? Blocks are in parallel only if they start from a pick-off point and ends at the same summing point like this. G1, G2. Okay, but this is not in that form, this is in feedback form. So that means as a first step, you can replace G1, H3 and this thing with a single block whose equivalent transformation is what? G1 divided by 1 plus G1, H3. Okay, so this much thing can be replaced by a single block whose equivalent transformation is G1 divided by 1 plus G1, H3. Okay, so as the next step, when you draw, you should replace this thing. Okay, keep in mind, actually when you solve, see, let me draw it here. This was the feedback. Okay, So when you eliminate this thing, this entire summing point will also should also vanish. But in this case, it will not vanish. Why? Because there's a third signal coming from H2. Okay. And in fact, see, you tell me, is there any difference like any between these two? Say they all are coming at plus signal polarity. Okay. Say this is X, this is Y, and this is Z. So I can mark this as X, this is Y, plus, plus, and this is Z. Is there any change? What's the output here? X plus Y plus Z. What's the output here? X plus Y plus Z. Okay. So you can, so if you want, you can split this summing point into two. Okay. So in this particular case, since there's a third signal at the summing point will not get vanish. Okay, it will not vanish, right? So what happens is that in the next step, you draw all these things with the summing point except for this blocks shown in red color. Okay. This part will not be there. Instead, there will be only one single block whose transformation is G1 divided by 1 plus G1 H3. Can you foresee that? Okay. So now what happens? You have one single block here, right? Whose transformation is G1 divided by 1 plus G1 H3. Now what next? That and G2 will be in cascade. So in the next step, you can club this much thing. Okay. Whose equivalent transformation will be G1 G2 divided by 1 plus G1 H3. Now what next? This single block and H2 that is in feedback. Okay. So what is G here? G is this big thing. What is H here? H is H2. Okay. So what will be the transformation? G divided by 1 plus GH. So you will get G1 G2 divided by 1 plus G1 H3. That is our G all divided by 1 plus G into H. So H2 into G1 G2 divided by 1 plus G1 H3. Okay. So when you take the LCM and simplify, what will you get? You will get G1 G2 divided by 1 plus G1 H3 plus H2 G1 G2. Okay. So now you have one big block whose equivalent transformation is this G1 G2 divided by big block whose equivalent transformation is this G1 G2 divided by blah blah blah. Okay. Now what next? This big block and H1 that is in feedback. So what is your G now? This is your G. Okay. This is your H1. Right. So G divided by 1 plus G into H. Again, you have to solve that. Okay. So what will you get? You will get G1 G2 whole divided by 1 plus G1 H3 plus H2 G1 G2 plus what? G1 G2 H1. G1 G2 H1. Okay. So now you have clubbed this much things. You have clubbed this much part. Now what next? This K, this big block and one base, they are in cascade. So you can find what's equivalent. So it will be what? This thing into K divided by S. Correct? Because they are in cascade. Okay? If you want, you can take the LCM and simplify that. Right? Now what next? What next? So this much is your one single block. Okay, this much is your one single block. Now what happens? This block and this channel. What's the gain of this channel? Zero? No. If it was zero, this channel would not have existed. Okay. The gain of this channel is one. Okay, it's a unity gain channel. Always in a block, we will represent a gain other than one. Okay. So if nothing is mentioned and if there's a single channel like this, the gain of this channel is unity. Okay. So now you see, you have a big block G, which is in feedback with the unity feedback and unity negative feedback. Means what's the meaning of negative, unity feedback? It means that your sensor is perfect. Okay. Whatever signal is coming here, by your first, that is coming here or here as well. That's the meaning. Sensor is perfect. Okay. But it's only an idealistic situation. Right. So now you can find the total block diagram. How this G divided by 1 plus G into 1, because gain of this path is 1, so H is 1 here. Okay, so you will get your transformation like this. the transformation will be k into g1 g2 by s whole divided by 1 plus g1 g2 into this thing. Okay, you should do and get it verified for yourself. Okay, when you see it appears to be everything appears to be clear, but I strongly advise you to take a book and solve it for yourself and get confidence. Okay, let's take one more problem. This was very simple. Obtain the transform function y by r. Okay, obtain the transform function y by r. Right. So, are there any blocks in cascade? G2 and G5. They are not in cascade. Why? Because there's a pick-off point in between. Okay. When will you say two blocks are in cascade? Only if the output of one block forms the entire input of the second block. Okay. So, if you can shift this pick-off point either to this side, either to the if you can shift this pick-off point either to the right side of G5 or to the left side of G2, then G2 and G5 will be in cascade. Okay. Right now, G2 and G5 are not in cascade. So now, where will you shift this pick-off point? Okay. Let us assume that we are shifting it to the right side. Okay. So now, when you shift this pick-off point to the right side, what happens? G2 and G5 will be in cascade. One solution, one simplification you can do. What next? You cannot do anything more. Okay. But in the meantime, assume that we are shifting this pick-off point to the left side of G2. What would happen if you shift this pick-off point to this side? Now, this channel is not there. It is starting from here. Okay. If you assume this pick-off point being shifted to this side like this, G4. Okay. If you assume like that, then what happens? Then G2 or G5 will be in cascade. Correct? What next? That G2, G5 and G6, they are in parallel. Okay. So you can do two steps. So always before you try attempting shifting your pick-off point and summing point, you should always try to see two steps in advance. You should try to foresee that. Okay. So if you have shifted this to this side, G2 and G5 would have been cascade, but then you could not have proceeded further. Okay. But if you shift this pick-off point to the left side of G2, then what happens? G2, G5 will be in cascade, that branch and G6 will be in parallel. Fine. Right? Now, once you shift this thing, what happens? So now your pick-off point is here. Now this is your this thing. So you see, you can club this much thing, okay, into a single block. What will be the transfer function? Transfer function will be G2, G5 plus G6. Okay. So now you see pick-off point is starting from here. Now what next? So you can see that this is in feedback. What feedback? Positive feedback. So as the next step, I can reduce this two. I can reduce this two as the next step, right? What will be the transfer function? G1 divided by 1. This is a positive feedback. So minus G1, G3. Okay. So 1 minus G1, G3. Understood? So now this has been reduced down into one single block. Right? Keep in mind, there's a pick-off point in between these two. Between the red block and between the blue one. There's a pick-off point here. Now what happens? This red block and... So now you see, this is not G4 anymore. When you are shifting this pick-off point to the left side of G2, what happens? This will be G4 divided by G2. Gain of this thing will be G4 divided by G2. Okay. Shifting the pick-off point to the left side. You can see the transformation. Right? Shifting the pick-off point to the left side. You can see the transformation. Oh, sorry. Shifting the pick-off point to the left side. Oh, G is coming, right? Yeah. G is coming. Yeah. So when you are shifting it to this side, yes, correct. G, it becomes G4 into G2, not by G2. Okay. G4 into G2. Right. So now this G1 by 1 minus G1, G3 and G1, G2, that is in negative feedback. So G divided by 1 plus G into H. What will be that? That will be G1 by 1 minus G1, G3 whole divided by 1 plus this thing into this. When you are taking the pick off point to the left side of the block, did I make a mistake? Pick off point to the left side of the block. Right, okay. So you can just write and solve and see how it is coming. Okay, I'll tell you the procedure. So this branch and this branch will be in feedback. Then what? That single block. So now we have only one single block. Okay, one single block. So this single block and this blue, they will be in cascade. Okay, and that is what is shown here. So what will be the final transfer function? Y by R will be G1, G2, G5 plus G1, G6 all divided by 1 minus G1, G3 plus G1, G2, G4. Okay. So when you reduce, when you do a block time reduction, normally, okay, I want to emphasize the word normally. Okay, normally you will never get a G1 square G2 or G2 square into G3 into G4 like that. Normally. Okay, because each block will be having a specific transfer function, right? This is G1, G2, G3, G4, G5, G6. Everything is individual transfer function, right? So normally you will never get G1 square H1 or G1 square into G2 into G3 cube like that. Okay. If you get like that, what's the conclusion? Conclusion is that your procedure is wrong. Okay. And in addition to that, when you do the simplification, every time you will get a simplified expression. Okay. Sometimes you may get things very big. Okay. That is also a case of doubt whether your solution is right. Okay. So always it will get simplified as you proceed towards the final answer, like this. Okay, there is no G1 square, G2 square term like this. Nothing is there. Okay, and it is a simplified form. Okay, let us try one more question. Obtain the transfer function Y of S by R of S using block time reduction. Okay, so you can see here there are no blocks in cascade. Okay, there are no blocks in cascade. G3 and G4 are not in cascade. Why? Because you have a pick off point here. Okay. So what you have to do, you have to shift this pick off point to this side or to this side. Now tell me, to which side will you shift this pick off point? To the right side, correct. What's the advantage if you shift this pick off point to the right side? G3, G4 will be in cascade, that and H1 will be in feedback. Okay, then that block and G2 will be in cascade, that and this thing, when you shift it to this side, will be in feedback. That block and G1 will be again in cascade, that single block and H3 will be in feedback. Okay, so this is the first step. So when you shift this point to the right side, what happens? It gets divided by G4, right? Now you see G3, G4 and cascade, G3, G4, this will be in positive feedback. So what will be the overall transfer function? I can reduce this everything into one single block. What will be the transfer function here? Transfer function will be what will be the transfer function? Transfer function will be what? G3, G4 divided by, this is positive polarity, so 1 minus G3, G4, H1. Okay, that will be single transformation. Now what next? In the next step, what happens? This red block and G2 will be in cascade. So you will get G3, G4, G2. Okay, then what happens? Then what happens is that this red block, blue block, this entire blue block and H2 by G4, that will be in feedback, negative feedback. Okay, that is what is shown here. Okay, so G2, G, this thing will be in this thing, right? So finally you will get this answer. G1, G2, G3, G4 divided by 1 minus G3, G4, H1 plus G2, G3, H2 plus G1, G2, G3, G4, H3. Okay, let me remind you, if you are proceeding in a correct way, you will never get squared or a cubic terms like G1 square into G2. Okay, and further, your expression will get most simplified form. Okay, if you are getting very long, say plus G2, G3, blah, 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 plus blah, 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 like that, you can make sure that it is wrong. Okay, when as you keep on simplifying the expressions, it should come in a most simplified form. Okay. Let us take one more problem. Obtain Y of S by R of S using block time reduction. Okay, that no blocks are in cascade, no blocks are in feedback and no blocks are in parallel. Means what? You have to shift either a summing point or a pitch-off point. Okay, so what can we do? Yeah, you can see, to solve a block diagram there may be many strategies. Okay, one may think like this: you can shift the summing point to this side. We can shift this summing point to this side. Okay, then what happens? G1, G2 will be in cascade. That and H1 will be in feedback. Okay, that and H1 will be in feedback. That is one possibility. Or you can shift this pick-off point to the right side of G4. Then what happens? G3, G4 will be in cascade. That and H2 will be in feedback. Right? So you can sort. Right? So what will be the final answer? Final answer, you should get something like this: G1, G2, G3, G4 whole divided by this thing. Okay? This should be your final answer. Okay. So in today's lesson, we had seen how to reduce a complicated big block diagram into a single block. Okay. So this forms the basis of analysis. This is the first step of analysis. Because as I said before, a system can have many subsystems within it. Okay. So you have to eventually model all these subsystems and find what is the overall transfer function. So in the next lesson, we will take up a new topic. Okay, thank you, and see you in the next class.